Hello, hello. Welcome to my talk at PKC 2021. I'll be talking about our paper on insecurity of the Diffie-Hellman Oblivious PRF, but there's also security of the same Diffie-Hellman Oblivious PRF implemented with multiplicative blinding method. It's a joint work with Hugo, Krawczyk, and Jiayu, and I'm Stanislaw. What is Oblivious PRF? The classic definition is that it is a secure computation of the following. This is a PRF, and the two parties, client and server, client has an argument X, server has key K, client computes PRF K at point X, the server gets nothing, and in particular does not learn what arguments the PRF was computed on. So this has found multiple applications. It's a beautiful crypto gadget. As Ford Kaliski, Xavier Boyan, and ourselves use it for something called password hardening. So an OPRF box can be basically maps low entropy secrets into high entropy one, right? Because S could be a counter, and still this is a pseudorandom value because of the PRF, right? In particular, in the opaque Eurocrypt 2018, we construct a strong asymmetric peg using this box because it allows to, this password hardening allows a password to be translated into the random key, and this pseudorandom key can be used in as a secret key for encryption or signature, you use it in a modular way in any authenticated key exchange. Another example, set intersection protocol by Hazai and Lindell, and then many others, many variants of this. Two parties can compute set intersection using OPRF, right? The client computes this on his set elements, the server Alice computes her set, the client can compute, compare these values and this, infer what X and I are intersecting, right? And because of PRF security, this reveals no information about points outside of the intersection. And there is many other applications, basically because PRF is a fundamental tool in crypto, right? It is, this can be a blind encryption, it could be blind decryption, it could be a blind MAC. And because you, for better or worse, we're using public key cryptography to implement this, from these particular constructions is not far to public key applications. So what are the first implementations of this? Well, using classic groups, here is a simple implementation. If hash is a hash on a group, this is a PRF. We call it hash Diffie-Hellman PRF. You can compute this obliviously in the following way. The client, using his argument X, he hashes it to a group and then exponentiates a random blinding value. This is a random group element. So therefore, this is information only hiding what X is. The server exponentiates this to the K, and the client deblinds and basically removes the blinding factor and gets back hash of X to the K and hashes that, right? It's a very inexpensive protocol. And it, with this paper with Akilovskayas, we showed that this implements a very strong notion of universally composable OPRF. In particular, that OPRF has property that it is independent, a different key input by the server creates a random, another instance of a random function. If there was no outward hash here, that wouldn't be the case because the two functions for keys, for example, K And 2k would be obviously correlated, right? The values of this function would be squares of the values of this one. Likewise, entering the x in hash disambiguates between, so that every hash query corresponds to a unique argument key pair. And the question is, can this protocol be even faster for standard groups again, right? And yes, it can. Very old protocol. It can be traced back to Chomsky's blind RSA scheme. So take this exponential blinding and replace it with multiplicative blinding. So you multiply hash of x with a random group element created this way. The server does the same. He exponentiates, she exponentiates to the k. And you can deblind again, but you need this g to the k value to do so, right? And so it works. The server can cache this public key value. Why? What did we gain by this? This protocol is computationally less expensive because we replaced what was variable-based exponentiations in previous scheme, right? Both this and that are variable bases. Here, there are fixed bases. This is definitely a fixed base. And in many applications, the public key, quote unquote, of the server is also a fixed element. Think of the set intersection application or authentication to the server using opaque, where you repeatedly authenticate to the same server, so you can just as well cache that public key. Okay, it's quite significant speed up. So is it just as secure as the previous one? It looks innocuous, this change, right? But here's a subtle vulnerability. The server doesn't have to create this output in a way that is intended. So a convenient way to think of this output is to think of a fixed key k that is a discrete logarithm between two elements. And once that is fixed, then b without loss of generality is the correct exponentiation of a, but perhaps with the multiplicative factor. And this factor delta, multiplicative shift, comes out in this SO. So what? Well, one way to look at it is that what the client computed is not the intended PRF, but the modified one, the one whose key is pair, k delta. Okay? Again, what's the difference? This is a PRF. So you obliviously computed a new PRF, should be happy. Not quite. The original PRF under this definition I was talking about, it's very strong in the sense for every two keys, these functions are independent in a random oracle under the gap GH assumption on the group. These new functions are not so. Adversary can program collisions in these functions. In what sense? We're going to call it correlated output. For any key, it can create a new key such that on a chosen argument X, this equation holds. In fact, you can see for any delta K, and in fact, any K star and any X star, it's easy to compute this delta star, right? Just divide this part by this part. So you can make this equation hold very easily. What consequences does it have? Well, two functions, these two different functions will collide for this programmed X star argument. And as we show in this paper on all others, it will still be independent. Okay, it's not immediately obvious and it's not very clear how exactly to model this, what does it mean? So that's partly what we do here. But essentially this is the case. Okay, how bad are these programmed correlations? Here is an application that this actually creates an attack avenue in. So Charlie on Monday he takes his password and he uses this OPRF service to harden his password, right, to translate it into a high entropy value, a PRF on the password, and uses the high entropy value to encrypt and authenticate his data, right? Why would he do this? Because if I see these encryptions, I cannot decrypt them using offline dictionary attack. These are not passwords. They are high entropy values. The only way to get them is to online attack the same server and on password guesses, right? So that is an online attack now and not an offline and can be timed out. Okay, but if the server is malicious, then the next data rally comes along, the server can switch the random function to the one where there was this programmed collision, which means that what does Charlie do with the recovered V prime? He tries to decrypt this data. It will succeed essentially only if these values are the same. And if it's not the same, the client will surely complain, right? Or retry the protocol. And if they are the same, then he will not. Server will learn whether the client is happy with the results or unhappy with the results. And this, whether results are correct is correlated with the input Charlie uses being equal to this programmed single place at which these two functions have the same output. So this way Charlie learns, the server learns Charlie's password. Now, if you use the exponential blinding method, which can be abstracted as a strong UCOPRF, this is not the case. In that case, for every choice of P, this was an independent random function. So the server could either keep the same key, in which case client is happy, or switch, in which case client is for sure not happy because this function does not collide on any argument, except for negligible probability of collisions in random functions, right? And so the server here doesn't learn anything new. It did learn something new in the multi-OPRF. So those are not equivalent notions, not the equivalent constructions. How to remove this effect of delta shift? Well, there is many ways. Add a non-interactive zero-knowledge proof that this stuff is correct, right? It's not an expensive proof. It's just a proof of discrete logarithm equality. So it's one or two exponentiations per party. Well, but the whole point was to reduce complexity rather, right? And it basically defeats the point unless you want verifiable of your ref, in which case, use that version because it's cheaper, okay? Actually, also if the client could cache this Z, so he could recognize, if he could recognize that this malicious server switched the Z value, in this application I was talking about, right, like together with the authenticated encryption, he stores the Z that was originally used, then he noticed that Z was switched, or he doesn't even bother taking it from the server, he uses the cached value. That eliminates the attack for that application. But in more generally, basically it needs some authentication. So you either have secure storage or you authenticate the value coming at you. In the context of password authentication, these are not good options. But here's another trick. Add this G to the K, this value into the hash. You do get it, you need it to compute this deblinding. So why not? This seems like a no-cost thing, and it again fixes this correlation issue. Here is why this is not actually a universal fix. Let's compare how mode-blinded oblivious evaluation and expert-blinded oblivious evaluation would work under these two regimes of the intended function this way and intended function that way. Now, why do we need bother looking at both protocols? Isn't this one cheaper, we just argued? There is one place it's not. It is a slightly larger bandwidth. Okay. And The security wise, okay, this is secure whether you hash it this way or that way. This one, the hashing this way fixes it. And here there is some vulnerability we just discussed. So isn't this a preferable option always? Well, not quite. Because if you hash, if you insist on hashing, then people basically cannot run low bandwidth protocol version because they will need the Z. So they either have to store it or they have to send it. The no Z version allows for minimum bandwidth implementation. And in particular for IoT devices, this seems like an attractive option. So in this paper we look, is it possible to standardize this? Is there a group of applications where you standardize the function this way, and then you can switch from either this implementation if you want low computation, but you're okay with larger bandwidth, or to minimize bias, this one, but either one works. And so the answer is yes, there is such a group. There is disclaimers. As you've seen, there for some applications, this would create vulnerability. So what we do here is that we model this as a relaxation of this strong OPRF model that is realized by exponentially blinded evaluation method. We model this as something we call correlated UCOPRF. And the nature of this model is that a server party can create keys which are correlated, meaning the output collide, but on only one argument X star for a pair of functions. Okay, and otherwise on all other elements, arguments, these two functions act like independent random functions. And we need a slightly stronger version of a gap one more DH to argue that this method, multiplicative blinded evaluation method, implements this functionality. What is this correlated OPRF functionality and what kind of applications are okay with it? So first, let's flash quickly this strong OPRF method model to see what's the nature of the relaxation exactly. So in a strong OPRF method realized by the exponential blinded hash DH, the server, every time somebody wants to evaluate this OPRF, basically the server's choice, whereas in the real world, like the server chooses her keys. In the abstract world, this is turns out to be equivalent to just pointing to some random function. So the server can continuously use the same random function, okay, or she can switch. But this basically refreshes the system, a completely independent random function now. So what is the new model, which this multiplicative blinded method realizes? Think of the application as password authentication, okay? Because I will on one slide try to both give tell you what the model is and argue what kind of applications this model would be good for. So think of password authentication where a client input is a password and it remains the same throughout, okay? For the purpose of this explanation. So initial OPRF computation, think of this as some initialization of a password authentication scheme. And the V0 value, the output of the PRF will be, because it's a password authentication, it will be used to authenticate to that same server S, okay, who's running this OPRF. Okay, in that case, well, the next evaluation comes, the server could use the same function that was used in initialization, but okay, without the generality, let's see what happens if the server switches and creates a new function. Well, because it's a correlated OPRF model, what that means is that switch to a new function In addition, the server can specify a list, including only one argument, at which these two functions will correlate. So in the abstract world of UC functionality, this will mean that this is a random function, except it will program to collide with this one on this input x1. And every time the client evaluates, the server, to maximize their chances, will use the following feature of the functionality. They will run a new function and provide a list of arguments on which this new function can be correlated with previous ones. And without the loss of generality, they can be correlated with all previous ones, except only one point with each. And that is actually possible with this multi-DH method. Here it doesn't really matter how it's correlated with these ones. What matters is how it's correlated with the base functions of use in initialization. And for every of these new functions, a server would put in one value because the model restricts them. You can program some collision, but only for a single argument. With a given function, you can correlate it on only one argument. Okay, so that's these new functions will be correlated on these chosen arguments with this base function. They can be also correlated with other functions, but that's really immaterial in this application. So if these VIs that the client retrieves are used to authenticate to the same server, then what does server learn? Well, as we were showing in that example earlier, the server learns whether a VI is the same as this V0. Because if this V0 was used to set up the authentication method, then in the case VI is equal to V0, the authentication succeeded. In the case it's different, the authentication will fail. The server will learn that. And basically, the correlations created the avenue that we showed at the very beginning, that the server learns whether the argument that the client uses is equal to the unique single value that on which collision with the underlying base function was programmed by the server. So the server gets a single online test for the argument with each such execution. And that's what we show by this correlated UC OPRF model, that there is only one, otherwise it's a random function. So it does create an online password test avenue. However, because it's only one per session, there is a very natural class of application for which this does not create a new attack avenue for password authentication protocols, where for every online interaction, the server already could run the base protocol on a guest password. And if the guest is correct, authentication would succeed. If the guest is not, it would fail. The server, by definition of what this functionality is, has an online password test avenue per interaction. So this is essentially why the proof that this correlated UC OPRF functionality goes through for opaque. To conclude, we show that this multiplicative blinded DH realizes relaxation of this OPRF method, which we call correlated OPRF. We show that essentially the nature of this correlated OPRF is that it creates online attack avenue, but only one testing point per instance. And in particular, there is a natural class of protocols for which this does not make a difference. And we show that this does not make a difference for opaque. The modified opaque therefore reduces in number of exponentiations to now basically just two times the base Diffie-Hellman, all right? And set intersection probably is also secure in this way. Could be other applications, right? But the warning is that you need to verify per application whether this correlated OPRF suffices for your security or not. Thank you very much.